Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States and His Excellency, Dr. Helmut Kohl.
Well, Barbara and I met on February 24th and 25th here at Camp David with Helmut Kohl, the Chancellor of the Federal Republic of Germany, and his wife, Hannah Laurie, and we were just delighted to have them here. The Chancellor and I had an opportunity to talk at length about recent political developments in Europe and about East-West relations. And I am pleased to say that we share similar views on the most fundamental issues. We both welcome the prospect of further movement toward German unification, beginning with the steps toward economic and monetary union that are proposed for the period immediately following the elections in the GDR on March 18th. If events are moving faster than we expected, it just means that our common goal for all these years of German unity will be realized even sooner than had been hoped. We share a common belief that a unified Germany should remain a full member of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, including participation in its military structure. We agreed that U.S. military forces should remain stationed in a united Germany and elsewhere in Europe as a continuing guarantor of stability. The Chancellor and I are also in agreement that in a unified state, the former territory of the GDR should have a special military status that it would take into account the legitimate security interests of all interested countries, including those of the Soviet Union. At the same time, the Chancellor and I agreed that we must continue to press hard for arms control efforts, which would sharply reduce military forces in Europe from the Atlantic to the Urals. We want to work together to have a CFE agreement ready for signature this year at a summit meeting of all 35 CSCE member states. The summit could also endorse our proposal for CSCE guidelines on free elections to help show the way and protect the emerging democratic institutions of Eastern Europe. Chancellor Kohl and I had a good discussion on East-West relations. We both support Chairman Gorbachev's program of perestroika, his efforts to reform his country's political and economic system. Chairman Gorbachev has shown true statesmanship in respecting the will of the people in Eastern Europe in trying to build new relationships based on cooperation instead of coercion. Since those difficult days following World War II, when America joined hands with the German people in their effort to build a new state and a new society, the United States has been their partner in a common dream. And that dream was to build a free, democratic, and prosperous German Republic committed to peace and working in close harmony with its closest neighbors. That enduring German-American partnership has never been stronger, as Chancellor Kohl, the leader of one of the world's great democracies, steps toward a golden moment in the history of his nation. Mr. Chancellor, it was a pleasure to have you with us, and now for your statement, sir.
Herr Präsident, meine Damen und Herren.
Mr. Mein President, erstes Wort ladies and gentlemen,
ist ein
my
Wort
first word
des Dankes an Sie, Herr Präsident,
thank you.
An Ihre Frau
I wish
Barbara,
to thank you, Mr. President,
auch im Namen meiner
and your
Frau,
wife Barbara, in my own name
so
as well as on behalf of my wife,
Aufnahme,
for this very cordial and friendly reception
in Camp David gefunden haben.
Here in Camp
die Atmosphäre
David.
Unserer
the atmosphere, the climate of our meeting is
symbolisch
symbolic
für den hervorragenden Stand der deutsch-amerikanischen Beziehungen.
American relations.
Gerade jetzt,
in particular
wo
now,
der Tag der Einheit
when the day
für uns Deutsche näher rückt,
unity is
erinnern
drawing
wir
near.
Uns
for
mit großer
German,
Dankbarkeit daran,
with profound gratitude of the fact that all of this,
die Unterstützung,
is not, would not have been possible without the close friendship
Staaten
and the confident partnership with the United States
können.
Of America.
Im Geist dieser Freundschaft haben
in
wir
the spirit
beide,
of this friendship, the two of us, Mr. President, in the course of these hours in Camp David, we have discussed a vast list of political issues. In the center of our conversations was the future of the transatlantic relations and embedded therein the path of the Germans towards national unity. Against the background of historic changes on the European continent,
we have reconfirmed our common beliefs.
First, the alliance of the free democracies in Europe and North America, and included therein the German-American partnership, are of fundamental importance for peace and security. This is true now, this will be true in future. Second, the security link between North America and Europe
is
and continues to be today and in future, for us Germans, that is to say, also for a united Germany, of vital importance. That is why we need the presence of our American friends in Europe, in Germany, and that includes the presence of American forces. Also for a united Germany and future, the maintaining the friendship with the United States of America and the expansion of relations with them will be an important task. We are happy about the ever closer economic cooperation and economic exchange in the fields of science and culture,
and about the
ever more meaningful meetings between people, in particular of the young generation. We are convinced that transatlantic relations must systematically be expanded in all fields. It is common security in the alliance, which is part of this, the ever closer contacts between the European Community, including political cooperation, and the United States. And this includes also our joint efforts
to make our way towards
a European peace order within the framework of the CSCE. Seeing the major changes in Central Europe, East Europe, Southeast Europe, the European Community continues to be an indispensable anchor of European stability. That is why we, the Federal Republic of Germany, in particular myself, do not only want to expand European integration, but we want to accelerate this process wherever possible. Beyond the big internal market, which is to be achieved at the 31st of December 1992, beyond the economic and monetary union, our primordial aim continues to be political union in Europe. That was the objective of the treaties of Rome, and nothing has changed in that area. It is our joint interest that the reform policy in Central, East, and Southeast Europe, and in particular the policy led by Secretary General Gorbachev in the Soviet Union, will be successful. Europe and North America are and continue to be open for cooperation as partners, in particular with the reform states, and I welcome particularly what you have just said about the subject, Mr. President. In the course of our conversations, we were also agreed that disarmament negotiations must energetically be pursued and be led to a success. On the path towards German unity, ladies and gentlemen, what we need in particular now is reason and a good judgment. We Germans
walk
along this path with a particular responsibility in the center of Europe. And we are doing so, if you like, along two tracks, which are of equal importance. On the one hand, we are leading intensive talks with GDR, and at present, we will in particular have to concentrate on the customs union and the economic community. On the other hand, we do have to consider that the link with our transatlantic partners, that European unity and comprehensive cooperation between East and West are being linked up with the development. We do respect the legitimate security interests of all states, and we respect people's feelings, especially the feelings of our neighbors. And I am saying this particularly addressing our Polish neighbors. The border question will be settled definitely by a freely elected all-German government and a freely elected all-German parliament.
But
let me repeat here what I have recently said in Paris already. It was in January of this year. Nobody has any intention of linking the question of national unity with changes in of existing borders.
President Bush ausführlich über die
in
Lage
the course of
in der
our
DDR,
talks, I have informed President Bush about the situation in GDR and the talks I have had a couple of days ago only with Secretary General Gorbachev.
Nehmen, Ihnen auch hier vor dem Forum der Öffentlichkeit
and I wish to seize this opportunity, Mr. President, to thank you publicly today and here before the press that on the eve of my trip to Moscow you sent me a letter
das nicht nur die Unterstützung für unsere Politik beinhaltet,
did not
das aber
only
in seinem freundschaftlichen
Geist
und der Selbstverständlichkeit der Partnerschaft and zu den großartigen Dokumenten deutsch-amerikanischer Freundschaft gehört.
Ich darf
zum Schluss Ihnen noch einmal sehr herzlich danken für die
freundschaftliche
Aufnahme
und für die guten Gespräche. Ich bin sicher, wir werden diesen guten Weg für die Zukunft gemeinsam fortsetzen. Lovely hours we have been able to spend with you here. I think this will mark our future cooperation as well.
You, might I suggest to the press that we alternate the questions between us? Is that agreeable with you, sir?
Herr Bundeskanzler,
I'm a Polish journalist. You have just declared, Chancellor, that you do not want any change of borders. Does this mean that you consider the Polish border as final?
My answer is very clear. It is contained in the text,
and I'm sure it has been translated correctly. According to the legal situation in our country, it is a freely elected parliament, the sovereign of the people, which has to decide this question. And this is laid down also in the treaties of 1970 and has been mentioned in the conversations which took place in those years again and again.
Beyond
this point, I've again and again declared during the past months that, and I do want to repeat, nobody wants to link the question of national unity with changes in existing borders. And nobody is permitted to doubt my attitude there. Question, do you consider it excluded that before German unity a treaty be concluded with the Poles about the Polish border? Do you consider this excluded? If I interpret the wish of the Polish government correctly, and I think I do, then the Polish government does have a very national wish that the competent sovereign, the legally competent sovereign, take that decision. In Poland, there are certain circles who wish that before such a decision to be adopted by an all-German parliament, decisions be taken in the two German states. In the federal German, West German parliament, we have already pronounced ourselves and confirmed our line about the non-changing of borders.
Might I just add the U.S. permission, U.S. position with your permission, Mr. Chancellor. The U.S. Respects the provisions of the Helsinki Final Act regarding the inviolability of current borders in Europe. And the U.S. formally recognizes the current German-Polish border. I just wanted to get that in. Yes, Craig.
Do you think there is some difference between what you have just said and what the Chancellor said? There seems to be a bit of equivocation on his part. Do you think there is any difference in the U.S. view and what the Chancellor is saying today?
I think we're in alignment. I would not interpret what he said as equivocating at all. And I've just given you the U.S. position.
Can you explain for us...
Okay, let's take this, then we'll be 2 weeks, and then I think out of courtesy we should alternate. Yeah, Charles.
Can you explain for us at this stage precisely how the 2 plus 4 works, what the sequencing is, whether they're consecutive, consultative? There's been so much confusion about that. Who's got what rights?
No, that those details have not been fully worked out in terms of timings of meetings and things of this nature. They have not been worked out. This formula was approved by the foreign ministers in Ottawa. And we simply have not tried to sit here in Camp Derp, David, and fine-tune the procedures for the 2 plus 4. You got to follow. I'm not sure I was responsive.
Well,
Charles.
I'm not sure that I know any more than when you started, and that may be part of the problem here. That it is not clear whether the Germans hold their meeting simultaneous with you, whether you're in adjacent rooms, whether you run back and forth. Yeah,
no, those details have not been worked out, and it would be wrong for the United States to try to sit on its own and work out with the German Chancellor all these technical matters that involve others. So we did not get into those details here today.
Ich möchte gerne auch eine kurze Bemerkung zu diesem Thema machen.
I would like to make a brief remark
about
this subject.
Glaube, dass es irgendeinen Grund gibt, die Dinge mit Misstrauen zu betrachten. Ich bin sehr zufrieden mit der Entscheidung, die in Ottawa getroffen wurde.
I'm very happy with the decision adopted in Ottawa 2+4.
Dass sich die beiden Staaten in Deutschland, vor allem auch nach der Wahl, nach dem 18. März, in einer besonderen Weise über dieses Thema unterhalten. Es geht ja nun wirklich die Deutschen primär an. Aber ich habe das ja in meinem Beispiel mit den beiden Schienen, auf denen die Entwicklung vorangehen muss, deutlich gemacht. Wir werden dann 2-4 miteinander ganz offen über alles zu reden haben. Mir geht es nicht darum, irgendjemanden auszutricksen. Das war ja sozusagen der Hintergrund Ihrer Frage. Sondern hier geht es darum, dass man über die Dinge dann sehr im Detail sprechen muss. Und ich sehe das absolut in einer brauchbaren Zeit für machbar. Können wir nicht nacheinander reden? Das hat einen Vorteil, dass man auf sich versteht.
If we talk to one another, this is we have a good chance of understanding one another.
How do the Poles come into this process? Are they just one of the 35 at the end of it? Herr Bundeskanzler, wie wird Polen in diesen Prozess eingebettet?
Well, there was, I know of Poland's feeling to want to make 2+4 into 2+5. Is that what you're asking about? The 2+4 has been agreed upon, clearly. No agreement would ever be reached that affects the Polish borders without Polish involvement. But there is no change that we don't sit up here and try to change an agreement that was taken by several countries at Ottawa.
Ich stimme dem ein.
There will be a lot of consultative mechanisms to deal with the interests, not just of Poland, but of our allies and everyone else. And the Chancellor is very good about that, and I hope we've been good about it. And it is essential that we stay on the same wavelength with our allies and friends. Excuse me, Helmut, I interrupted you, sir.
Ich will das unterstützen, was der Präsident gesagt hat.
What the President
ich sehe natürlich das besondere Interesse, Polen hat.
There is a particular
und ich bin sicher, dass wir im Verlauf dieses Prozesses auch diese Arbeit
process,
Wege finden, um eine befriedigende Lösung
we will find ways and
für alle
means
Beteiligten
of zu finden.
Ich glaube, jeder von uns hat
everybody.
Das Gefühl, dass es hier eine Besonderheit gibt.
There is a
aber ich habe es für wenig dass
but
wir
I don't
beide
consider
heute, während die anderen Partner nicht präsent sind, darüber irgendwelche Erklärungen
nobody else from amongst our partners here is trying to decide about things and make declarations today.
Across Europe from Poland to Britain, and our own former director of intelligence, Mr. Helms, has called the German unification march a runaway freight train. Given the history that the role that Germany played in the two wars in this century, shouldn't there be some assurances before this marriage takes place on borders and security?
I think all those matters will be discussed in the various consultative mechanisms that we brought up. But I prefer to look at Germany's 45 years of contribution to democracy and to the security of the West. And that's what we are focusing on. I have stated the U.S. position, which is not to be afraid of German reunification, but to understand when peoples, brother on one side, brother on another, want to get together as one country, as they were before this artificial division resulted as out of World War II. So we've already crossed that bridge. We welcome reunification. But it's not for the United States to set a timetable. It's not for us to say how fast. It is for us to guarantee, as best we can, in consultation with our allies, that whatever evolves will be stable and that peace will be the result. So I've already given you the view in my statement about the U.S. toward unification, and we are not in a process of trying to speed it up or slow it down. It's a matter for the German people, matter for the discussions that will be taking place in multilateral fora.
Ein Moment, Church. Ein Moment. Ich möchte zu dieser Frage gerne etwas sagen.
Just a second, let me say something about this, because this is a very central question. I'm grateful.
Die Frage der deutschen Einheit ist eine Frage des
The question of German unity is a question of the right of self-determination, and all peoples of this earth have the right of self-determination. It's a part of the Charter of the United Nations. It corresponds to the principles of CSCE. It corresponds to the major democratic traditions of our world.
In all documents,
all treaties which have been concluded with the Federal Republic,
to reform
the unity of the German nation had always been confirmed. The second point is that the people in the two parts of Germany do want to unify, want to overcome the artificial division. The people in the GDR, in a peaceful revolution, I think the most peaceful revolution of history, have made it clear that they want it by shouting, we are the people, we are one people. Now, if I have a particular feeling seeing and hearing this,
and
I believe that we do have a responsibility to be conscious of the fact that we are situated, geographically speaking, in the center of Europe. We have a certain history. We must understand that there are certain fears on the part of our neighbors. And I'm talking about serious fears and not only the pretended fears, because there are people who pretend they have fears, but what they mean is that they fear the economic power of the Federal Republic plus GDR. The President very rightly said last year the Federal Republic was 40 years of age. In the course of 40 years, it was a loyal and reliable partner in human rights and the defense of freedom. In 1983, I put my political existence at stake by agreeing that arms be deployed, NATO arms, American arms, and missiles be deployed on German soil. So nobody has to tell me what a reliable partner is. But I do take all the other data into consideration, and I've also made it clear that part of my answer to you, that I am amongst those who want to pursue political union of Europe. The federal government is a government which is ready to delegate further competences to the European Parliament. In other words, we want this united Germany to be ever more embedded in an integration process with its neighbors. So nobody needs to be afraid. And as regards the economic strength, I can only say that the European community has been able to draw great advantage of the economic strength of the Federal Republic and be able to draw even more advantage from the economic strength of a united Germany.
I'm sorry, did you recognize all
go ahead.
All right,
Mr. President,
I'd like to know perhaps the core question. Do you trust that Germany will never become an aggressive, resurgent military power? And if I might ask Mr. Kohl, do you forsake such a plan?
I have stated that the U.S. position is that we welcome unification. And clearly, that would not be the position if we held the fears that your question alluded to. I do think that one way to help with stability, not in relation to this question, but European peace and stability, is to have a strong NATO and to have U.S. troops, if wanted, stationed in Europe. But our policy, if I shared the fears that you're talking about, clearly we might well have a different policy. Norm, let me take this one, Chancellor, because I recognize two at once, and then...
Chancellor Kohl, how durable we can see the commitment to NATO and the continued presence of U.S. troops on German soil, given the broad support in the Federal Republic right now for a neutral, unified Germany, given the probable outcome of the East German elections, and given some of the political pressures that you may come under later this year with elections in December.
Also zunächst einmal ist das ja meine Sache, die Wahl in der Bundesrepublik im Dezember. Ich sehe diesen Wahlen mit großer Ruhe entgegen.
These elections in the Federal Republic of Germany in December.
Inwieweit wir zuverlässig sind, ich habe das Beispiel eben gebracht. Wenn ich hier gestanden hätte, im Frühjahr im Herbst 1982 oder im Januar 1982 hätten die meisten ihrer Kollegen bezweifelt, dass die Deutschen stationieren werden. Wir haben stationiert. Und deswegen brauchen wir wirklich nicht eine Nachhilfe im Blick auf Zuverlässigkeit. Neutralismus wäre ein totaler Irrweg für die Deutschen. Ich sehe keine Mehrheit in Deutschland, weder in der Bundesrepublik noch in einem Wiedervereinten Deutschland für eine Neutralisierung.
In the Federal Republic, nor in the United Germany,
das letzte Jahrzehnt dieses Jahrhunderts zu dürfen uns zutrauen, dass wir die Fehler, die in diesem Jahrhundert schon begangen wurden, nicht wiederholen. Aber ein Fehler war natürlich auch zur Zeit der Weimarer Republik, dass man damals Deutschland isolierte. Deutschland darf auf keinen Fall isoliert werden. Das ist ein Teil des Ganzen sein. Das wollen wir.
Haben Ihre Gespräche den Weg zur deutschen Einheit hier beschleunigt oder verlangsamt?
Ich glaube nicht, dass das unser Thema war. Muss überhaupt sagen, dass ich diese Diskussion, wer beschleunigt oder wer verlangsamt, für wenig sinnvoll halte. Ich hatte im November die 10 Punkte vorgeschlagen und einer Zeitvoraussetzung, die völlig anders war wie heute. Ich hatte im November wirklich gedacht, das ist erst wenige Wochen her, dass wir auf dem Weg zur deutschen Einheit mit ruhigen Schritten vorankommen können. Dass wir die Chance haben, eben erst eine Vertragsgemeinschaft, dann konföderative Strukturen und dann eine Föderation zu bilden. Die Entscheidung der Menschen in der DDR hat diese Beschleunigung herbeigeführt. Eine Beschleunigung, an der ich nicht interessiert bin. Denn überlegen Sie einmal, seit dem 1. Januar bis zum heutigen Tag sind erheblich über 110.000 Bürger der DDR dort weggegangen. Wenn ich die Zahl richtig im Kopf habe, ist es die Einwohnerzahl einer Stadt wie Philadelphia. In 8 Wochen. Dieser Prozess muss gestoppt werden. Deswegen kam ein Angebot.
In the matter of 8 weeks.
So this movement must be stopped.
That is why I made this offer of concluding a monetary union in order to stop this movement, in order to hold people back, in order to make them stay at home.
If you ask me, we now need a possibility of proceeding along this path towards unity step by step with good judgment.
We need this for ourselves.
Die Dynamik, die jetzt entstanden ist, entstand aus der Situation der Menschen in der DDR und nicht, weil irgendjemand diesen Prozess beschleunigen wollte. Ich hoffe, dass nach der Wahl in ein paar Tagen am 18. März das neu gewählte Parlament schnell eine Regierung wählt und dass dann eine Beruhigung eintritt und wir den Weg nicht in einer Hektik vorangehen. Ich bin an einer Hektik nicht interessiert.
German press asked that I thought he said for both of us to comment on the nature of the talks.
You know, in diplomacy, they always say full and frank, and you can interpret that any way you want. But the benefit of this kind of meeting for me is you can talk in a very informal setting about any subject at all. And the relationship that I have personally with Chancellor Kohl and that the Federal Republic has with the United States enables us to talk very frankly. But what I come out with, in addition to this statement that I made, is the importance to keep our allies involved. I believe the Chancellor shares with me the importance of the United States and the Soviet Union staying in very close touch. I know he shares with me the importance of our making progress with the Soviets on arms control and on other areas. So as this meeting winds down, it was extraordinarily frank. We can talk as one does with friends, but we have so much common ground here, including how we're looking at unification and including the need to be sure that it doesn't look like either one of us is dictating to allies security arrangements or anything else for the future. So it was a very good meeting.
Mr. President, I wonder if each of you gentlemen could comment on whether you would anticipate that a reunited Germany will see fit to develop an independent nuclear weapons capability.
Nein. Diese Diskussion ist bei uns längst ausgestanden. Wir haben keine Sehnsucht nach einer Atommacht.
Yes, Senator.
Mr. President, if I could follow up on a question you were actually asked a week or two ago about who the enemy is these days. It seems that less and less it is the Soviets. So would one purpose of keeping NATO intact and keeping U.S. troops within NATO in Germany be to, as some analysts have said, to keep the Germans down?
No. The enemy is unpredictability. The enemy is instability. It is for that reason that there are agreed security provisions, and that's the answer to it. Who out here was smart enough to predict for fact certain the changes that have taken place any time in the last year? Certainly no one up here. Maybe Chancellor Kohl, but not the President of the United States. And so What I think we want to do in a period of exciting change is to have a stable Western Europe. The Eastern European countries are throwing off the yoke of communism. The policy of NATO has prevailed. The Soviet Union is engaged in dramatic change, but nobody can predict for facts certain what will come. And so what we want to do is use our good offices and our in alignment with NATO to help with stability. And that is in the interest of the United States of America. Some are saying in our country, and the Chancellor and I talked about this, well, we ought to take all the troops out. Or some are saying take all Soviet troops out and all U.S. forces out of Europe. In my judgment, that would not provide for a stable Europe. And so it's back to your question. The enemy is instability and unpredictability as this rapid change continues to unfold inside the Soviet Union and inside Eastern Europe.
Ich würde das Stichwort von der Stabilität, Instabilität gerne aufnehmen. Ich halte das für eine der wichtigsten Aufgaben aller Verantwortlichen in West und Ost, und das gilt in hohem Maße auch für die deutsche Politik, dass wir alles tun, um eine Destabilisierung in Europa, vor allem auch in Mitteleuropa, zu vermeiden. Ich werde das Notwendige dabei tun. Ich bin mir übrigens in dieser Frage nicht nur mit dem Präsidenten einig, sondern genauso mit Generalsekretär Gorbatschow. Wir haben jetzt vor wenigen Tagen darüber gesprochen. Was übrigens
also
with
Secretary General Gorbachev, regarding the relationship between NATO and the Federal Republic, you seem to have made a mistake in your calendar. We are not. This is not 1945. This is 1990.
Going back to what you were saying before about keeping allies informed, would you like to see a NATO summit called together to discuss the unification?
Well, I will let Chancellor Kohl also respond to that. I don't think at this juncture we need a NATO summit. Jim Baker just had a very successful and forward-looking meeting up in Ottawa, I wouldn't say that what's called for now is a NATO summit. We're talking about a CSCE summit, provided there's a CFE agreement. I have, as the Chancellor knows, and we discussed this, a one-on-one meeting with Mr. Gorbachev in the late spring. We have a G7 meeting. So we've got all kinds of consultative mechanism set up in addition to the 2+4, and there'll be a lot of bilateral talks, and maybe the Chancellor would like to respond about the need for NATO in concert to do more. But the big point is keep each other informed. And I don't think it has to be done at a NATO summit, because I think most NATO allies share common ground. There's a concern here or a different suggestion there. But generally speaking, I think we're pretty much on the same wavelength with our allies. Did you want to add to that, Herr Chancellor?
I fully agree with what the President has just said, but let me elaborate on that. What is happening now
is ja für viele eine völlig überraschende neue Situation.
Is a surprising
new situation. Auch für jene, die immer davon gesprochen haben, aber
in Wahrheit
nicht daran geglaubt haben, dass der Tag kommt.
Talked about it, but never thought the day would really
Jetzt
come.
Kommt der Tag.
Now the day is coming.
Deswegen ist es ungeheuer wichtig,
that
dass wir
so
möglichst viel miteinander sprechen.
We talk to one another as much as possible, so that
Und das trifft vor allem uns auch als Deutsche in der Verantwortung, in der wir stehen.
And that is
particularly
important for
us, Germans.
I agree that this is not the time to convene a NATO summit, but I do agree that we need many detailed conversations within the European community. On the 28th of April, we will have an informal summit, an extra summit.
Dezember in Paris
just
hatten, in Dublin. Irland hat jetzt die Präsidentschaft.
In Paris in the beginning of December, the forthcoming one is going to take place in London, Dublin, Ireland. Now
ich selbst werde bei Gesprächen mit den Bevollmächtigten der einzelnen Länder der NATO in Brüssel zur Verfügung stehen.
Ich habe eine Fülle von persönlichen Kontakten.
Gestern vor acht Tagen traf ich mich in Italien mit meinen Kollegen aus Belgien,
had and
aus
I will
den
be
Niederlanden,
having a number
aus Luxemburg und aus Italien
not long ago I
und
met
anderen.
With my Italian, Luxembourg, Dutch
bevor ich herging, habe ich lange mit meinem Freund Malroni gesprochen,
Wir
werden auch uns verabreden,
my friend Malroni, I had a long
Mir geht es darum,
with him.
Um es einmal einfach zu sagen, dass wir mit ganz offenen Karten ohne Geheimnistuerei
what matters to me is that we make it clear that we play very friendly and fairly and want to cooperate with all our friends and partners, and the result will be good. Do you agree that United Germany must be a full member of NATO? And Mr. President, do you think that at the end of the 2+4 process there will be a peace treaty? And that the peace treaty will then no longer be necessary. I can give a very simple answer to your first, to the first part of your question, yes.
And we agree with that. And eventually the four powers that were set up right at the end of the war, that'll have to be resolved. But whether it requires a formal treaty or something of that nature, I'm not sure. But there will be a resolution, so there will not be a continued need for this four-power arrangement, looking over the shoulders of a democratic, unified Germany. On the aisle back here.
Moment, er war der Nächste. Da sehen wir. Ja.
One question. In these conversations, which were so frank and free, did you also discuss what needs to be done in the event that the Soviet Union would not agree to Germany being a member of NATO? We talked about many things, and also about what we want to discuss, we need to discuss with the Soviet Union.
We will do what Lyndon Johnson did. We will reason together. And it'll all work out. Yes, Sonia.
Mr. President, with apologies to your guest, a question on another subject. If Daniel Ortega is elected in Nicaragua today, will the United States deal with him as the legitimate leader of Nicaragua? What would the policy be, sir?
Policy will be, right, short range, to wait and see how free, how fair the election is. I don't know whether this is going live into Managua, but the last thing I want to do is make any hypothesis about a victory of that sort, because our view is we'd be better off with those who have professed the democracy is the route to go, and so I will cross that bridge. However, when we get there. However, let me say this. If these elections are certifiably free and fair, whoever wins the election will find a better climate in which to improve relations with Nicaragua. We've had difficulty because Nicaragua has said that they're not giving arms to the FMLN. Now they say, well, if we're elected, we won't give arms to the FMLN. There's certain things that are unacceptable, not just to the United States, but to other countries in this hemisphere. So we got to see where we go. But clearly, a free and fair election that is certified as such, in spite of the shortcomings that have been reported to me by observers, would be very, very helpful in this relationship.
If I may follow, would such an election call for a U.S. response, an American initiative?
Well, again, it's too hypothetical because we've got to know not only how an election works out, but we also need to know what follows on. I thought the Secretary of State put it very well in testimony before Congress the other day when he said, look, there's got to be a period of establishing, he didn't put it this way, but I will, of bona fides. I mean, and I would cite the FMLN as one clear area where there should be change. A democratic process is important, but what follows on in terms of freedom of the press, freedom of institutions there, freedom to protest, freedom to speak your mind is also important. And so all I'll say is that whoever wins that election, if it is certifiably free and fair, that's good. That's a positive thing, and we would certainly take that into a strong consideration, the will of the people having been expressed, as we determine what steps next to take. But I would love to see Nicaragua living peacefully within its own borders, not trying to subvert its neighbors, and giving its people a shot at democracy. And once all that was sorted out, why, I can guarantee you there'd be better relations with Nicaragua.
Chancellor, you talked about elections in December. Seeing the developments in Europe, in Germany,
can you foretell that there will be a federal election or an all-German election?
I do assume that we will have a federal election as it corresponds to the Constitution. Have you talked about nuclear short-range missiles over the weekend? We have talked about how the process should be developed in the nearer future and what decisions we'll take with regard to the decisions taken in Brussels spring
this
last
guy,
year.
Right over here.
Mr. President, you said you were surprised that perhaps unity was coming sooner
the news yourself had expected. Do you believe that those of your other allies within Europe who are cautious about the pace of that unity are wrong, ill-informed, or do they not understand what you have been talking about?
I think they will rejoice in the agreements that in what we've said here today. I can understand individuals looking at a problem in a different way. But I can tell you that the alliance is pretty firmly together on these security matters. I think they're going to be very firmly together on what the Chancellor said here today about, said again, about NATO membership. And so I can understand individual countries wanting clarification or raising questions. This doesn't trouble us at all. I have stated the United States position.
And I will keep restating it, and I will be discussing this with our allies. But look, none of our allied leaders have predicted the rapidity of this change or the dynamics of the change in Eastern Europe. And so we're all trying to sort it out. But the main point is not that there's not nuances of difference, but that there is so much common ground as the way we look at the problems and as the way we look at it with the Federal Chancellor. Yeah, back here in the middle.
That's a question for both leaders. I noticed in your opening remarks you were more specific than the Chancellor in referring to NATO. I wonder if that's an indication that there is some discussion or perhaps some sentiment among the Germans that NATO may somehow fade away or be transformed into a different kind of European security arrangement, and whether that was discussed this weekend.
Well, we ourselves, Jerry, have talked about a broader or a slightly different roles. Clearly the stability through the military aspects is part of it. But we've talked, and we talked up here with Manfred Werner the other day about a broader role for NATO. But I don't feel at the end of these talks that the Chancellor and I are looking at this differently. I'll let him, if there's some nuances there, let him say so, but I don't think so.
Chuck, just a second. Ich kann nur sagen, es ist doch eine ganz natürliche
I can only
Sache.
Say this is a very natural thing that
Welt,
seeing the dramatic changes in the world with which we're confronted, think only of the Warsaw Pact
mit dem Warschauer Pakt,
and its
NATO,
present situation.
Warschauer Pakt, USA, Sowjetunion, sprechen über die zukünftige Entwicklung.
With the Warsaw Pact, NATO versus Warsaw Pakt.
Manfred Werner hat in diesen Tagen vermutet auch hier mit Recht darauf hingewiesen, dass die politische Bedeutung
indicated,
der Allianz
quite
der NATO
so, that the political,
zunehmen wird. Das ist doch
richtig. Of the NATO alliance
und wissen Sie, es gibt ja nicht wenige, auch in den Reformstaaten Mittelost- und Südosteuropas, die sich im Augenblick nun wirklich nicht von der NATO bedroht fühlen,
Europe,
sondern die die NATO als einen Hort der Sicherheit und der Stabilität
NATO
betrachten.
Fortress of
und das muss man doch mit bedenken, wenn man
and,
über die zukünftige Entwicklung spricht. Ich bin in der Frage ganz optimistisch. Ohne eine Weiterentwicklung dieser Gedanken werden wir ja auch in der Abrüstung nicht wirklich weiterkommen. Wir haben doch die fantastische Chance in diesem Jahr, dass wir in wichtigen Kapiteln der Abrüstung zu weiteren Verträgen kommen. Ich glaube nicht, dass dies die Stunde ist zum Pessimismus.
I do not think that this is the time for pessimism.
Mr. President,
the desire on both of your parts to have a unified Germany remain in NATO, you also said that there should be some kind of special arrangements to provide certain guarantees, security guarantees for Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union. Does that preclude any participation at all with the unified Germany vis-a-vis the Warsaw Pact? And would it be conceivable that there could actually be Soviet troops in a unified Germany?
Jedenfalls ist eines ganz klar, dass ein vereintes Deutschland nicht in zwei Paktsystemen sein kann.
A United Germany cannot belong
die zweite
to
Frage
two
ist eine Frage der Souveränität. Wir
the
werden Übergangssituationen haben.
Will have
das ist eben das Thema, über das man verhandeln muss. Gegenwärtig stehen in der DDR 380.000 Soldaten der Sowjetarmee. Nach den jetzt vorgesehenen Reduzierungen wird es ungefähr noch die Hälfte sein, wenn ich die Zahl richtig im Kopf habe. one has agreed upon, half of that number will
be remaining there for the time being.
Many things will have to be looked into.
And I cannot and will not give any final position here. United Germany, that much is clear, has a sovereignty of its own,
That is quite clear.
But then in the transition period, one can still think about things which will be helpful.
Can you give any more details of what you discussed in terms of providing these security assurances beyond what you've said so far?
Ich glaube, das ist nicht das in einer Pressekonferenz, sondern erst müssen wir darüber verhandeln und dann eine Pressekonferenz.
Because we first must negotiate and then have a press conference about the results.
Let me ask, I noticed Mr. Fitzwater looking, we may have overextended our time. Would it be agreeable, Chancellor Kohl, if we each took one more question?
Ja, gerne, George.
The situation where U.S. troops are still deployed in Germany, while the Soviet Union has withdrawn all its troops from German soil.
Yes, I can. And the reason I can envisage such a situation is that if that's what the Germans want, that's what ought to happen. And we are not, the U.S. troops are not in Europe against the will of any single country in which they're deployed. Not one. And the Soviet troops have been for years inside the territory of countries that haven't wanted them. This is a fundamental difference. So my answer is yes, I can so envision.
Mr. Chancellor, both of you have talked about U.S. troops and Soviet troops, but I'd like to ask a question about Germany's own troops. Both the Federal Republic and East Germany, the GDR, have substantial armies. I know a final decision about those armies won't be made until a united Germany is formed, but as you look ahead, what's your personal feeling? Do you think it will be necessary for Germany to retain an army of this size, or in the future will it be likely that those forces will be scaled down?
Also zunächst einmal ist das ja die Frage der Truppenstärken, eine Frage, die uns zwar als Deutsche direkt berührt und interessiert, aber die eingebettet sein muss in die gesamteuropäische, die sicherheitspolitische Entwicklung. Ich hoffe sehr, dass wir auf dem Weg von Abrüstung und Entspannung noch große Schritte machen werden. Ich hoffe auch, dass wir, die Deutschen, dabei Nutznießer sein werden. Deswegen kann ich Ihnen jetzt heute und Dinge unmöglich, zumal ich nicht der Vertreter einer gesamtdeutschen Regierung.
Today, I cannot answer that question in particular
since I'm not the representative of an old German state. And I cannot tell you at all in what dimensions a future German state would conceive of these things. In this question, as well, one has to consider the effects that that will have, that the answer will have on all our neighbors. I have spontaneously answered to the questions put on me by one of your colleagues. He asked, did we want to have nuclear arms? And I spontaneously said no. And that is of greatest importance. There shouldn't be any fears in that direction. By the way,
this and many other questions I consider to be able to be solved. We have had more difficult questions to solve. If I consider legal questions of private property in GDR,
the social structure, das nicht in Hektik zu machen, sondern mit viel Überlegenheit.
Is enormous, and that is again why I plead it shouldn't be put under time pressure, but we should be advancing and solving these problems step by step.
Thank you all very, very much.
Well done, Helmut. Well.
Damit Sie jetzt noch einmal.
Over here.